Hey guys, this is Sean DeGray. Nobody knows who that is, but it's me.
And you are listening to
the Gritty Bowmen.
It's all in perspective, right? If you could make $150,000 a year, but you had to work 80 hours a week and you were committed to a corporation that you hated what you did, is that more lucrative than making $70,000 a year doing what you love with a lot of free time? And who's richer?
One of the things I never want to say, and I even think this with life, is I never want to say, like, what if? Mm. Like, well, I hate that. I hate that feeling. What if I would have done this? Or what if I would have just tried this? Or what if? What if? And there's very few things that I say what if about. Very few things. And that gives me a lot of peace of mind. So that helps give me drive, because I don't want to ever say what if.
Randy always says this, you're going to run out of health before you run out of money.
But is that picking fly shit out of chili is what I'm getting at? How much of a difference? Because what I get in questions is, okay, should I buy this pant or this pant because this dries faster? Now, if you're talking about getting down wet, that's a crisis, right? You're not going to dry it out. How much of a difference between 8% to 11% or from 6% to 8% like? Are you talking about 5 minutes in a heated tent? Or
it depends, you know. I'm still trying to think about the fly shit and the chili thing.
I got a lot of those, by the way. let's say rain gear, for example. One of the things that gets brought up is like an MVTR or mm-hmm. the waterproof and breathability rating.
Our stance on it is, so when we test any of these laminates, mm-hmm. say the storm front rain gear, for instance, there's no reason to test the laminate because nobody goes out wearing the laminate. They go out wearing this... You know,
finished product.
There's a membrane, which is a laminate in the middle. You have a face textile, which is printed a lot of times.
Right.
And then you have a backer. Mm-hmm. And so that's the sandwich. That's what the finished garment's made out of. So that's what we test. We have to sit there and develop something that's never been developed. You're constantly learning. Like, you're never going to be able to push the envelope if you don't push the envelope.
Right.
And if you're not given the runway to do that. And that, quite frankly, is like one of the funnest parts of my job. Yeah. So we're working on a pant for 2018. And we're putting together a textile that's never been developed before, because that's a commitment we have to do it right. And quite frankly, I'm the guy that if we couldn't do it, then I just wouldn't do that product. We would just cancel it.
All right, folks, welcome to the Gritty Bowmen podcast. We're at the Western Hunt Expo, and I got my illustrious co-host Aaron Snyder, aka Aaron. Can you say that?
Aaron.
Aaron.
You done messed up.
And then we've got Sitka Gear here with us, some folks from Sitka Gear. We got our friend David Brinker. And first on the podcast, first time going live here with John Barklow.
The one and only.
The one and only John Barklow.
I'm just stoked there's no guitar.
How do you know there's no guitar?
Well, there better not be any. Harmonica maybe.
But yeah, for folks listening, you don't need. There's no guitar. Aaron and I are not going to show off our singing ability.
I've got my sexy phlegm, though, from the cardio this morning. I might sound better today.
Yes.
Not till tomorrow night when you get called up on stage to sing.
That's right.
Sing. Oh, that's funny.
You've got the, you got to perform tomorrow.
I do.
Yeah.
You guys want to get up?
No.
No.
What?
No.
I'm going to be sick.
Dude, do you have any comments we've got so far? Especially me. I've got the stick to the podcasting job comment quite a bit.
Oh, man.
That was fun, though.
Barklow told me specifically on the way over here, he said, if you bring your guitar, I'm going to kill you.
That's funny.
Oh, shit.
Well, we want to have you on the podcast today, talk about Sitka Gear. You guys have some amazing products that you've come out with this year. Aaron and I just finished using your whitetail line in Alabama, and... It was
nice.
So impressed. I mean, down from not just what it's made out of, but then all the little design features, we geek out.
It's good.
Yes.
Almost every day I'm impressed with what these guys do in terms of, like, I'll be, you know, going through one of our jackets or I'll have it on and be like, hey, Barklow, what does this do? And he'll be like, it's for X. And I'll be like, man, that's thoughtful. That's
right.
Great.
What? So the Fanatic hoodie is a big one for me. I always wear a hoodie of some sort or whatever. And Brian's like, Aaron, it's got mittens. I'm like, I know it has mittens, Brian. I actually had one of these before. And he was like, man, when the wind's blowing, I'm like, I'm pretty sure the guy that designed that was probably thinking the same thing. It is nice. And then you had the face mask on. He's running around with a face mask
on. Like a ninja.
Yeah.
You know?
You look like a ninja.
We almost, he does. We haven't went over some of our favorite pieces we've used or whatever. Just, we haven't had time. We've been at shows. But that Fanatic hoodie, I like that Fanatic hoodie.
Yep. John, tell us, for folks who don't know who you are, tell us a little bit about you, your background, and tell us a little bit about, you know, what you do at Sitka.
So I am the big game product manager. So that's all I focus on is big game product. Yep. And work with an awesome team, but came from the federal government prior to that. Mm-hmm. For 15 years, I taught up in Alaska, spec ops guys. Developed gear for them, taught them how to use it, you know, got to see a lot of people make mistakes, got to make a lot of mistakes on my own, got to work with some of the best technical apparel brands and hard good brands in the market. Mm-hmm. And so that really, you know, that coupled with my passion for hunting was like I wanted to work for Sitka. And lo and behold, I actually had a job. I'm actually the first person to ever hold the job of big game product manager.
Really?
So that's all I think about 24 hours a day. So it's pretty cool. You know, you talk about the whitetail line just to kind of give some call out to those guys. But, like, we literally have a tree in our product development space.
Yeah.
So it's a tree that was hollowed out, cut, put around a big metal post in our place. We have a tree stand strapped to it. And so what's the best way to develop stuff for a tree stand hunter?
Yeah.
Have the dude just sit in a tree stand and just hang out and go, do those pockets make sense? Like, does this make sense? Does that make sense? Like, go, that, you know, range? Everybody's an authentic hunter. That's a given, I hope. But it's like, go sit in a tree stand, whitetail guy, and the next 3 hours, tell me what you come up with. Or put a layout blind in the middle and get in there, waterfowl guy, and tell me where you need the padding. Like, tell me where you start to get sore.
Yeah. The rangefinder pocket was the first thing for me that was huge, just because I don't really need binoculars or it makes me move even more than I normally shouldn't. But having that there was super handy. And that was what, and then there was pockets on the pants I had down here, which was nice for when I was sitting down. It didn't quite fit my Copenhagen can, but I don't think that was the design intent for the pocket.
You should add that feature in for sure.
Well, so you know the pants. Yeah. You know the pants from the military, right?
Oh, yeah.
And they have the pocket down here on the calf, and everybody's like, oh, wow, that's badass. Like, why don't you do that? And I'm like, dumbass, do you know why those are there?
It's a breaching pocket is what we
like,
use.
Like, come on, man. It's like, or if you're driving.
Yep.
Right?
Yeah.
If you're walking somewhere, that doesn't make any sense.
Yeah.
So, you know, think through the whole process and, you know, real feature-specific for the end use is what we're always trying to get at, you know.
You guys had some cold weather down there, huh? For, I mean, it's
couple
humid.
Days there,
yeah, a couple days were cold. Cold in the morning, 30 degrees.
He wore
That's
his,
cold down there, I feel like.
Oh, for sure.
He wore his bibs. I never wore the bibs. I wore the pants, which I had the thermals on underneath. He wore the bibs every day. Not every day, but.
Yeah, pretty much.
Yeah, almost every day. But it was hot in the day, but it was cold enough. And it's a wet cold, which I hate, so it means colder for
the
me.
Zipper where it goes from the hip to the shoulder. Yeah. And then you've got your...
So you can have the kangaroo pocket.
The kangaroo pocket is money.
Yeah.
Especially because I don't like to wear gloves when I'm getting ready to shoot, right? I don't execute the shot quite the same. I just don't like... If I can avoid wearing gloves, I want to. But what happens is with that pocket, and then it looks, you can slip hand warmers and stuff in there
inside.
As well. Yeah. Which keeps the pocket, I mean, it's just genius. All those little details that just seem to never end.
And I've got horrible blood flow in my hands and my feet from assholes like you throwing me in a hole in the ice. And so that kangaroo pocket is huge. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah. The rewarming drill sucked. But yeah, I that was a big one for me. I shoot a back tension release as well.
Yeah.
So being able to have that back tension in there with a hand warmer, I use those body warmers, is a big, big thing. And, I mean, I normally have to – I take the basically like the back, you know, you open them up for heating up your back when you have lower – well, I have them – I put them on my – when I'm super cold. I actually strap those to me in the morning, not on a backpack hunt, mm-hmm. but to, well, that was a mistake because with all that crap on and that, I about had a heat stroke the first morning because I just wasn't prepared to be that warm. And it was cold. It's just normally I have to have that along with my other clothing. I didn't need those wearing, you know, the system that you guys had sent out to us.
The wind blocking ability was phenomenal.
To me, that's money.
So critical.
Like that allows
especially
me to
up
stay
in
on
tree.
Stand, right, all
yeah.
day.
Yeah.
You
yeah.
know?
The other part that was that really stood out to me was I was like, why like this? Why this finish? Why like this fleecy thing? And, you know, I was just kind of like, it just surprised me, right? Like, mm-hmm. it's not like any other garment I've ever really hunted in. But then I'm like, look how quiet it is. Like, dead silent. And those whitetail were, like...
A little skittish.
Little high-strung.
Yeah.
Any little sound they would hear. And I was like, man, I could move around. And this thing is just not making noise.
We're trying to look for every single detail, every advantage we can give the hunter to just have the best experience he can, right? And so if that's sitting in a tree stand and just seeing deer, not shooting some, yeah. awesome. If that's, you know, him being successful and killing something. But that's why we're out there, right? We're out yeah. there to enjoy ourselves.
Well, I told Aaron, there's a couple of things. One is I was like, dude, I'm excited to go hunt just so I can wear my Sitka gear. Right? Like
yeah, he did say that.
What's next? Well, you know, I was playing with all this stuff, and we'll go through Aaron as we use it, and we'll share with our audience the parts and pieces that we like the best and how we like to wear them. And often, Aaron and I kind of wear a different layering system. Like, yeah. you know, we have all the parts and pieces, same gear, but I tend to wear certain things all the time where Aaron wears a different set.
I don't sweat very much either, yep. and he sweats, so I can wear a bit more clothing hiking than he can, things like that.
Yeah, as soon as we start climbing a hill, I'm down to the T-shirt. Aaron will start the hike in a T-shirt, vest, and jacket, and he won't take it off. And he'll get to the top, and I'll be sweating in the T-shirt, and he'll be still dry.
Mm-hmm. But see, that versatility is important. You both have your own systems. They work for your physiology, the way you hunt, et cetera. But, you know, you have that versatility.
Yeah.
There's no right or wrong as long as you wear those pieces and
that work.
Know, yeah, that work for you yeah. within that system.
That's the beauty of a good layering system.
Yeah. No, it is. And, I mean, people, when you first hunt with somebody that hasn't hunted with technical clothing, I'm a layer shredder. I mean, I'm a layer guy. I'm pulling them off, putting them on, changing them out. And,
yeah.
And guys, especially on a hard backpack hunt, you know, I literally get in and I'm stripped down to my underwear, and I'm drying off what I had and putting on immediately, dry back on and layering back up before I lose whatever heat my body's generating. Mm-hmm. Before I lose it, I'm swapping everything out to get it dry. And, you know, a lot of guys look at me, they're like, what are you doing? I'm like, oh, I'm getting my wet stuff on anyway. And they don't understand the system, but then when they never see you shiver the entire mm-hmm. time, I'm like, hey, it makes sense. And that loose, you know, cleanliness, overheating, looseness of the military thing. But I was trying to explain like the idea behind the first layer, how tight that's supposed to be, how much of a gap between the first, second, third layer. And the one thing I'm not used to, which you guys did right, was the sizing. I screwed that up pretty bad the first time I ordered because I wasn't smart enough to read the performance fit, the standard fit, and the Arctic fit.
Expedition.
Expedition, sorry. I guess what I'm thinking is for Arctic weather, meaning super cold, the Expedition fits like to go over the top of things. Right. So one of the things that people, I don't think, you know, realize is four layers of an accurate system is in good material is better than seven layers in an inaccurate system with crappy material. Or it has been for me. So that was a big thing.
Well, you know, what's kind of fascinating to me is, you know, 2017, mm-hmm. how long have people been talking about layering? And hunters, that like the vast majority of hunters still don't get it. Like they're getting it. We're talking about it now. People are building systems. But like this is still relatively new. These concepts are relatively new.
Especially as you move out east, you know, it's been around for a lot longer out here than it has been out there.
Yes, absolutely. And I think until you, I think one of the reasons out east is because You're not climbing mountains as much, and right. you're just not covering as much country.
Yeah,
right. Well, your cold front jacket, which I've worn when I wasn't supposed to, was one of the key things for me on sheep hunts because it was waterproof. It was very there was no wind coming through that.
Yeah.
And just the way when I wear that jacket, rain isn't an option. Rain isn't as big of a deal. It's snow. Mm-hmm. But that jacket for me, I could pull off the layers I had layered up with in between and still hike with it. Mm-hmm. And everyone's different, like you had said, physiology, everything else. But for me, if I had a base layer and then a fleece layer and then a puffy jacket and then that jacket, when I went to move, I just pulled off the fleece and the puffy, put that, and then off I went. I'd stuff that in the top of my lid, and mm-hmm. then when I stopped again, I'd put that on. Where I would see guys strip off the one layer that actually kept water off of them and put that in their pack and keep the layer on that makes them sweat and take off, and I'm like, what are you doing? That makes no sense whatsoever. Right. But they don't really think about it, and then they're really sweated up. Worse than they probably could be, and now it's wet because of the snow and the body yeah. heat, you know, is melting the snow. And you guys have done a very good job with your system to cover everything. And we covered that in a podcast we talked about. There is no other company on the market that is remotely close to covering everything from top to bottom.
Yeah, I mean, especially with the stuff for 2017, I think you can hunt in the hottest environment in the world, quite frankly, right now, and you can go hunt musk ox.
Yeah.
Right, or polar bear, and we have you covered in between, everything in between.
Yeah, your new Ascent pants, I would imagine, are going to probably be worn more than any other pant in the history of mankind for even in relatively cold weather. Because mm-hmm. for me, I'm a freak. I don't like, although I wear your Timberline pants a ton, but if I'm really moving out and it's a Colorado type of shift, 40 degrees, mm-hmm. I'll just wear thermals under those when I need to, because I like to be super, super basically sleek on my lower layer, and those are, and they fit me really well.
Aaron even looks like he has a butt when he wears those pants,
which is important. I have no acetal problems. It's bad. It's pretty bad.
Seriously though, that's another thing that we were joking about the other day is even a guy that's not all that fit looks really dang good when he wears Sitka. What's the deal with that? Like, we got a photo last night. We were with Matt Best over at Black Rifle Coffee. Aaron walks out and he's like, "This stuff just looks good."
I believe I said I may look tougher.
That's right. That's right.
I don't know if we can get Avery to look skinny. We can try.
There is a limit.
Yeah, there is a limit.
But no,
we have one of the best technical apparel designers in the world, bar none.
Yeah,
who lives right in Bozeman with us. He's done it for 30 years.
Because not only does
this guy's amazing, and that, like, that's all the back end stuff. You know, mm-hmm. we get to come on here and talk about it, but it's that gentleman who's the designer. It's a developer we have. Like, these are really talented people who are really good at their craft.
Because it's functional, highly functional. It's got all that athletic cut and everything. So you just feel like you feel great moving in it, but then it also looks stylish too.
Yeah,
what, like, doesn't really matter to me, but you know,
you're so
it helps. It helps. Aaron needs it the most.
Right? I do. I will say, talking about that, your first set of Timberline pants, in the spirit of full candor, I look like I shit my pants anytime.
Yeah,
I look
like
on.
You had a diaper on.
Yeah, and so you guys fix it. That's one of the things I was going to bring up. Is the
we don't always get it right the first time.
Well, and that is coming from a design standpoint, that is a tough piece to get right with that padded butt. Yeah. It's hard to get right, but. I put the in Amy. I put them on, and she's looking at them, and she's like, "Is that the same?" And she's confused. And I'm like, "Well, the ones I had before, 3 years old." And she was like, "Wear those, wear those all the time, because I don't have an ass at all. It's horrible." But
send the other ones back.
The honestly, I wore those so much. I eventually, from shale, sliding down on shale. I eventually, after, I mean, roughly 250 days. In those pants, or maybe a little less, I finally ripped a hole in them. Mm-hmm. And what's crazy, I sold them on Archery Talk for like $30 less than I bought them for, with a handy-dandy sewing, a military sewing job where I'm doing it by hand. But one of the things I was going to ask you guys about was just because numbers get thrown around the industry so often, you know, of technical specs, and I have a decent understanding of the technical specs. But what I think, what I would like for you guys to help out is the listeners to understand what those numbers mean. You know, as far as how you come up with those numbers, when you talk about, let's say rain gear, for example, one of the things that gets brought up is like an MVTR or mm-hmm. the waterproof and breathability rating. Now, I know we had some stuff tested from a third party, and you guys actually, and I talked about this last year, you guys actually tested better than what you spec'd. It wasn't by a whole lot, but at least we know you weren't lying. And that was
in a podcast that we did last year called My Camo Is Better Than Yours.
Yeah, I mentioned your Sitka rain gear because I said, hey, it actually tested better than
the on all the independent tests.
On all the independent testing. So what I had come to kind of find out, or what it seems like in that testing, was some companies will have all three layers laminated together and have it tested, and other companies will just talk about that one breathable rating, like just the middle layer before it's all kind of glued together. Now, with you guys, do you know what yours would test out at with just that center layer? Because I don't know. We never did that.
Yeah, I mean, I have the numbers back. Yeah.
But what's the point? Because how a hunter's going to use it.
What is the point? You know, I mean, our stance on it is, so when we test any of these laminates, mm-hmm. say the storm front rain gear, for instance, there's no reason to test the laminate because nobody goes out wearing the laminate. They go out wearing this, you know,
finished product.
There's a membrane, which is a laminate in the middle. You have a face textile, which is printed a lot of times.
Right.
And then you have a backer. Mm-hmm. And so that's the sandwich. That's what the finished garment's made out of. So that's what we test.
Right.
And we're very careful mm-hmm. to not overinflate those numbers so that that consumer, when he buys it, they have the best experience based on what we tell them the garment can do.
Realistic numbers, right.
Those numbers, quite frankly, you know, because we have in the lab just to see, we can manipulate, we can pull the backer off, and you're going to get a much better breathability rating. Mm-hmm. You could pull the face textile off. You could test just the laminate. There's lots of ways to do it to manipulate the number. But at the end of the day, does that help anybody out? Like, if you buy my product because you think it breathes really well and then it doesn't. Like, that doesn't help anybody out.
Right. We talk about that with some Kefaru products because, you know, they'll list weight ratings with everything. And then you go to the next guy and his tent weighs 2 pounds less, but it's
just a canopy.
Correct.
And you're like, what?
Or there's no stakes, or there's no guidelines, or there's no,
And I mean, we test it with the cord and the stake, what you need to actually erect it and not die. And I literally have gotten in arguments with guys on forums where they're like, my, you know, whatever, this shelter is actually 17 and a half ounces lighter than yours. And I'm like, well, no, it doesn't have the center pole, it doesn't have stakes, and it doesn't have the 24 feet of guy line hooked to it.
Right.
I just want you guys to know the weight that you actually have to pack up the mountain, not the, you know, it'd be like us weighing our frame, or you guys have packs, right? It would just be, if you just say, oh, my frame sheet weighs whatever, well, that's not an accurate count because you got a lot of other crap hooked to that
but
thing.
You but you do find you run into that problem with marketing because people will look at the number, that integrity and that honesty, yes, I think in the long term is excellent. But in the short term, sometimes that can cost you because you have a guy that says, you know, I chose this shelter because it weighed a pound less when it wasn't really true.
Yeah.
And that's where I think the consumer needs that education.
Yeah. Well, you know? And on that note, like, what's your, I don't know, thought process? Just because I've worn everything from the Carhartt cottons, which we all probably wore starting out, to, you know, heavy duty merino wool in the old, I mean, probably what we all wore when we were young, we're all about the same age, to now, obviously, this we have polyester, nylon, and a bunch of every other fabric in between. What's your theory on, like, the poly, nylon, 3%, 9%, 12% spandex content or whatever? What do you feel about that, especially when it starts to come to deal with pants?
Well, so nylon's always going to be more durable, right, than say a poly. Mm-hmm. So nylon's nice. The problem with nylon is a lot of people can't print nylon.
Yep.
So, you know, there's...
What does that mean to the consumer?
So there's people running around that say, you know, hey, we wet print nylon. But to get a, you know, the highest quality durability at the lightest weight, like, you have to be able to print it. So you know, that's something we've worked really hard on, and we do a really good job. But you know, poly's, you know, polyester's not bad either, mm-hmm. but nylon's just a little better. Nylon will absorb, you know, theoretically no water. Poly absorb just maybe a little bit. But there's, I mean, there's lots of stuff that goes into it. But now to get stretch, when you start putting, you know, like Lycra in it or spandex, mm-hmm. those kind of things, you know, I personally, my experience is if I could get none mm-hmm. and still get some mechanical stretch, I'd be all about it.
Yeah.
Because anytime you start adding that spandex, you are going to get water absorption, right? Mm-hmm. And it's going to take just a little longer to dry out. So, you know, to get textiles that'll work, I mean, 8%, you know, that's what I kind of shoot for, not getting any more than that.
But is that picking fly shit out of chili is what I'm getting at? How much of a difference? Because what I get in questions is, okay, should I buy this pant or this pant because this dries faster? Now, if you're talking about getting down wet, that's a crisis, right? You're not going to dry it out. How much of a difference between 8% to 11% or from 6% to 8% Lycra? Are you talking about 5 minutes in a heated tent? Or
it depends. You know, I'm still trying to think about the fly shit and the chili thing.
I got a lot of those, by the way.
You know, but if you get 8 or 10%, you're pretty good. Like the vast majority of people, you're not going to be able to really tell the difference. When you start getting 15%, you know, that kind of number and above, especially the environment you hunt in. Okay, yeah. We live in Montana, Colorado, some of these drier environments. Like, the reality is most of us probably aren't going to be able to tell the difference. You start going on a 10-day sheep hunt. You start going for black bear in BC. You go on a float hunt, you know, for 14 days where you can't get off that river. Like, all of a sudden, you know, do you want your pants to dry a little better in a more humid environment? Yeah, I would like to, because those pants are not something I generally bring a second pair of.
Right.
Like, base layers maybe, but not those pants.
Yeah.
And so, you know, you get pinched and you're stuck on a gravel bar and you have to dry out. Like, does 30 minutes of being dry or could be the difference between, you know, getting out of there okay or maybe being hypothermic. But but generally speaking, you know, 10, maybe even 12%, but you start getting upwards 15 and more, it really does start to make a difference.
And for what I use and buy from, whether it be backpacking gears, stuff from you guys, there's only one set of pants that I got that was 15%. It was from Marmot. And they were pretty bad. Like, I did notice with them, anything between...
What were they, yoga tights?
It was, they were like big homie baggy pants, but they were super, super, you know, I don't know if they were the screes, but either way, there was a lot of stretch and there was a lot of water absorption.
Yeah.
But then I went down, you know, they had another set that was 9%. It was a significant difference
in
6%.
Yeah.
But anything between 6 to 10, it's harder
you're,
for me
you're,
to...
You're picking fly shit out of chilies.
Exactly.
Right?
Picking the ass out of a pepper.
Yeah, I mean, that's not something that I tell people that they really need to go look at. I mean, a lot of the performance fabrics nowadays, they have some stretch. You can work mechanical stretch in where you don't have to put elastic, but, you know, it's not this crisis thing. Mm-hmm. Most part, you're looking at... I don't know. I can't tell you. I don't want to be quoted exactly, but, you know, I bet you there's no more than 10 or 12% in anything we do.
Yeah.
And, you know, and it works just fine. It works just fine. Obviously, you start talking cotton and those kind of things, 50% elastic, yeah.
I've had better luck with nylon and durability and breathability in some cases anyway, it seems like, depending upon how much spandex was in the polyester, the higher it got, the less they breathe. And that was the one thing I had... amazing, I don't know, you have to edit out swamp ass with that set of pants from Marmot. I mean, I just was sweating like crazy.
Yeah.
Where you got that less spandex content, I didn't get as much sweat down low.
So. Well, our newest scent pants for this year, so we've been able to wear them for almost 2 years now, mm-hmm. I guess. And mm-hmm. I mean, we would go running them. I mean, they've got great stretch, they're super lightweight, they breathe, they dry crazy quick. I mean, you could literally, we would go out and run at lunch.
Yeah. Yeah.
Just to see, like, not that that was the best product for the job, but it was like, let's go run on these things and see what they do and see how quick they dry. And
yeah.
How do you determine what you know, technology to use in your products? How do you decide what products you're going to use? How do you find them?
So we have people, right in Bozeman. Matter of fact, they'll go to Asia in April. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we're already working on 2019, believe it or not.
Yeah.
And, you know, a person like myself will sit there and we'll have an idea. We have a piece of white paper. We write a product concept like, hey, this is what I want this concept, this yep. product to do. And we give them a whole bunch of details. And then we basically cast them out into the world and go see if you can find anything that will fit this kind of design parameter yeah. that we're looking for. I'd say, you know, 50, 60% of the time, we can if we scour hard enough.
Yeah.
The other 40% of the time, we have to sit there and develop something that's never been developed. Yeah. So we're working on a pant for 2018, and we're putting together a textile that's never been developed before, because that's a commitment we have to do it right. And quite frankly, I'm the guy that if we couldn't do it, then I just wouldn't do that product. We would just cancel it. But so, you know, to kind of get back to your question, so let's say they come back from Asia, we have a couple textiles, we'll get that designer I talked about, and we'll get a simple pair of pants, and I'm the goofiest bastard out there hiking, and I'll have a pair of pants that has one textile in one leg and one textile in the other.
One
and
of them is purple, one of them is yep. pink.
Oh, it's all kinds nice. Of crazy. And I got a shirt that's split garment in half, because it's the only way to know on any given day with, you know, the environmental conditions, like, yeah. which one's breathing better? Which one dries quicker? Which one's stretching? Like, is wow. one of my legs, like, literally, is like on a hump? You know, is one of my legs getting more tired because it has less stretch or more stretch or whatever? And like, truly, just it's just on the ground, just like rolling up your sleeves, kind of testing.
And when you write that concept, Barklow, you it's pretty high level. You give some priorities, but you don't get into too much detail, because you literally want them to find the best solution yeah. to solve the high-level problem.
Yep.
And if we need to develop it, we will.
Yeah. But you list your priorities. There's design priorities. You can't have it all, right?
White tail piece needs to be quiet.
Right. You know, that right. needs to be quiet. Big game piece needs to be durable, whatever it is. That's the number one priority. Maybe list
yeah,
them.
Right.
And then after that, if we're like, okay, I think we're on to something, we've maybe got it down to one or two textiles, while we continue that development, we'll send it off and get lab testing and mm-hmm. see if what the human perception is panning out in the lab. Now, we don't necessarily do that with every single thing, but let's say, hey, I'm really liking this pant textile. Let's send it off and get the UPF rating, yeah. right? So the Ascent shirt, it's not a cool number, so we don't like to, you know, talk about it like on the hang tag, but like it's got a UPF of 29. Like,
wow.
I could have said it had 30 and put a 30 hang tag on, but yeah. that'd be lying. It's yeah. a 29 UPF. I know that. I knew that going in, and I didn't want to apply chemicals to get any more than that. But so we'll do that in conjunction with
you should
the
probably
field
tell everybody
testing.
What UPF means, because a lot of people probably don't that's listening in.
So what is it? Ultraviolet.
I was going to say, because I couldn't remember all of it. It's basically the sun resistance
the sun rating.
Coming
yes.
through, but I couldn't remember the whole what the acronym was. But the UPF rating, which is
ultraviolet protection factor or
yeah,
like that.
Is not as important for some. At Colorado, you can stand up and talk to God in person at 12, 13,000 feet. It is amazing how important that is.
Oh, it's huge.
I mean, you can get fried with a t-shirt yep. on when you're not. When I say fried, not the part that is covered, because it just burns right through it. It's amazing.
Right, and the fishing community's known this forever, right?
Yeah.
But the hunting community really hasn't done a lot with that. So
yeah,
I think the greatest thing about the process he's talking about is even after they bring this textile back, it's the greatest thing ever. He really likes it. He puts it in a sample. He still really likes it. We get down to the 11th hour, and something happens. Something's not exactly right. We're totally okay with going, you know what? Scrap it. It
yeah.
doesn't matter how much we've invested into that whole process, which can take about, what, 18 months to
yeah.
2 years?
Yeah. yeah.
We've scrapped a lot of things like that because, you know, you take risks in doing it that way with not going with proven textiles.
Yeah.
And you sometimes you get to the end and there's something you didn't think of where it's like, oh, man, crap, that isn't going to work.
And we're out there using it. I don't want to go out there and use an inferior yeah. product.
Well, and we're not going to put it in the hands of, you know, our athletes or the consumer. There's no way. So we'd rather just kill it and start over from ground zero. And believe it or not, that happens a lot. It's pretty
yeah,
impressive.
Or just punt till the next year and see if we can figure it out.
Yeah.
But
I was listening to Mark Kenyon, Wired to Hunt podcast, maybe a year ago, a little over a year ago. And and he was talking about Sitka. One of your engineers, somebody was talking to him about products. And one of the things that he had asked was, you know, what's your... I don't remember how he got into it, but basically the guy at Sitka said, we don't go out and design products based on we need to have a jacket that costs $400. So let's figure out like cost of the jacket first, and then let's build down from there. Mm-hmm. You guys don't do that. And he made it very clear that you guys are out there to build the best product. Whatever the cost of the product is at the end of the day, it's just what it is.
I think that was me, by the way.
Was it?
Yeah.
It's all about solving the problem that he identifies in the concept. What's the problem statement? What's the problem we're trying to solve? We don't want to know what it's going to cost to solve that problem. If we get to a point where it's ridiculously you know, expensive or whatever.
You could have this, but it's a $4,000 jacket. That's
$1 million.
Yeah.
But they...
I'm not a business guy. I'm a product guy. Yeah. And so, you know... We're developing stuff right now. I've got some ideas for that 2019 line. I don't know what it's going to come in at. Like, it may be ridiculous, but I have to try. And the business doesn't give me that pressure to build the $400 jacket or the $99 pant. Now, I will tell you, in this, you know, maybe it sounds a little dramatic, but there are products that our team can build and has built that the world's not ready for.
Yeah.
So they're not ready to pay for it, and they're not ready to accept the technology, and someday they will
but
be.
But the time and dollars and effort went into creating it to get to that point to make that decision on your team.
But it was all time invested. It was good time invested, right? Yeah. I mean, you're constantly learning. Like, you're never going to be able to push the envelope if you don't push the envelope.
Right.
And if you're not given the runway to do that. And that, quite frankly, is like one of the funnest parts of my job. Is that we can sit down and brainstorm and go, yeah, let's do this.
Yeah.
And see what happens.
I think it's interesting the way you talked about having one pant leg here and one pant leg here being different products and you're testing it. At the end of the day, you can tell me all you want about the products you put into a pair of pants, what its numbers are, what its ratings are. But at the end of the day, the proof is in the pudding. You put it on, you wear it, and you use it, and you find out, as a hunter, how durable it is, how breathable it is, how waterproof it is, how well it performs, how comfortable it is. You figure that stuff out.
It's hard for companies to admit this. Where would you say you're weak at? If you were going to pick one thing you want to improve on.
I got
to
go.
Yeah. If you wanted to, I mean, because I get asked to me at Kafaru, and I know exactly. So what would you guys say? If you wanted to work on something, what would it be?
I'll speak for Big Game.
Yeah.
So I'd like to work, our gloves are good, and we got some better gloves, but
That set of gloves I just wore.
Yeah, no,
we have some
nice ones.
Yeah,
but I think we need to carry that through the line.
Yeah,
and then quite frankly, I don't think our packs are as good as they can be. So we don't want to get into anything. Mm-hmm. I mean, here's just our mentality. I'll just speak for myself. I don't want to get into anything that I can't do the best.
Yeah,
and I'm not saying I can. You know, I'm not trying to like be better than anybody necessarily. Mm-hmm. Like, I don't think I can be better at Kafaru than packs. Maybe because that's all they do. But I want to at least be as good as them. Like, I want to have, and what I mean by that is I want to have best-in-class product.
Yes.
So there may be other people side-by-side with me, but damn it, I don't want anybody above me. Like, mm-hmm. I want the pinnacle position, and that's all I think about.
I would say
that's all I do.
Glove-wise, you have Big Game covered from what I've got.
So we have a couple really nice gloves in the last couple years.
Yeah.
I've got a couple more we're redeveloping.
Okay.
And it's... the technology we want to bring out and the way we do it, it might not resonate with everybody, but there's better ways to build gloves than most people are building them right now.
Gotcha.
And so we were going to bring it out in 17, couldn't get it. We were going to bring it out 18. In 18, couldn't get it. We're pushing it to 19, so that's a perfect example. It's like, but when we get it right, we'll bring it out.
We love gloves.
I love
my
gloves,
we
love
too. Like, we don't like to wear them if we don't have to, but but that's just it. If they were better... then I would want to.
Yeah, gloves and feet, right? They're really difficult.
I think the beauty of being in the position that we're at as a brand is the ability to, we always know that we can always do better with everything. I mean, if you think that you're the best at everything, you're going to get left in the dust. The moment that he doesn't have sleepless nights and get up every morning wanting to crush, that's the moment that, you just can't do that in this environment, especially with all the competition in the market today, which is great. It keeps us all ahead of ourselves.
Yeah.
And that's...
So on another switching topics just a tiny bit, like there's more than one way to skin a cat, right? There's a lot of ways you can create a waterproof garment. And hunting the Northwest, hunting in POW, and spending some time in some seriously wet and humid weather. breathability is important, but so is, it's got to be waterproof. Nothing can ruin a hunt faster than everything being wet. Mm-hmm. So the, based on what's on out on the market today, why the waterproof technology you're using, and what would you say, how does it rank next to other waterproof technologies that are out there?
So we think the, you know, the Gore laminates that we use are the best, just from our testing.
Mm-hmm.
And we're always trying to get better. I mean, there's some stuff maybe we can roll out in 2019. You know, we had talked kind of off air about, you know, how they make that sandwich.
Right.
That's really where the technology comes in, is how you put those layers together to get
that
breathability.
Because not every Gore-Tex is the same. Like if someone if someone bought a $90, you know, $50, $90 pair of boots, and they're like, and it had a Gore, it said Gore-Tex on it. That's not the same Gore-Tex that's in, let's say, a Sitka jacket.
No, every laminate really has like a use profile, and you know, right now I'm trying to find a laminate that meets a certain use profile
mm-hmm.
for the upcoming years. And you know, so the Gore-Tex that's used in the waterfowl line is different than what's used in the big game line because the use profiles are different.
Right.
I'm not sitting there for 12 hours a day, maybe for a bear hunt, but then you're going to get up and jam and go after that bear. So those breathability ratings, those waterproof ratings, everything has to, you try to really pick and choose and kind of
grab
plug
the
in
best the, laminate for the use.
Yeah, right, exactly.
I don't need something that if I got shot with a fire hose would stay dry in, when I'm hunting, you know,
Colorado,
big game.
Probably.
Big game
right.
in general.
No,
rain
exactly.
just doesn't have the pressure behind it.
Right.
To
But it's not just the laminate, right? Mm-hmm. But it's also the design. So, you know, there's certain designs where, you know, you look at a hood and I'm like, oh, that jacket's going to leak. Because it's gonna get wet, it's gonna weep through
it's
the holes,
leak
it's gonna
in.
Go right into the jacket, et cetera. And you know, we've never got it right every time, and we've fixed those things, but we've learned. And then we take that garment, we put it in the rain room. I mean, we see what it's, will it really hold up? You know, field testing, lab testing, does it work? Is it the right laminate? And if not, you know, we're okay with changing it out. You know, if it just doesn't work or there's new technology that comes on the market, we're okay with switching out. But it's not just It's not a one or two laminate to kind of suit them all. They're, you know, the dew point laminate is completely different than the storm front, which is completely different than the cloud burst for the use profile, the build, kind of, you know, the whole spectrum of things. Does it have to be lightweight or more durable? Is it a guide piece or is it for the, you know, the dude jamming for 12 days on a sheep hunt?
We know when you come up with something that's new, does it get you pretty excited?
Oh, yeah. No, I mean, I'm a kid in a candy store half the time, right? I'm also nervous.
I'd be a little
I'm also like a nervous papa because, you know, you put this stuff out there and it's for everybody to judge and it's not going to be for everybody and that's okay. But the people it is for, it's going to be like, it's going to be awesome. Right?
One thing I've found is I don't ever mind since, and with what I do, we're expensive. You guys are expensive too. I don't ever mind when people complain about the price because the price is the price. If the price wasn't the price, you would go out of business and no one would have the in their hand. It's
no,
just how
exactly.
life works.
And, you know, it's an investment, too.
It's other stuff
your,
will bug
you know,
me, but
your product, my product, it's not going to wear out.
Yeah.
It's an investment. It's going to be with you for a while.
I have to say that, not to keep bringing up the cold front jacket, but that thing has saved my life. That one I have, and that thing is expensive.
Yeah.
But I'm on my third year. It's got blood all over it, but I'm on my third year with it, and it's still fine. The thing with me, for what I paid for that jacket, which was I think it was 10% off or something. I think I paid $589 maybe or $569. Does that sound about right? I think it's what I paid.
Yeah.
I think because it's six something. Yeah. But if I make it for $100 a year on rent, is how I look at it. I'm good. If that thing gets out on me in 5 years,
yeah,
I don't care because I paid $100 a year. For that jacket. And I don't think people ever look at things like that. Like $100 a year in rent is pretty cheap. Like on a pack or on boots or in that case, that jacket. Now, if you go out 2 days a year and your wife doesn't let you go hunt, that might not be the jacket
then
for you.
It might not be worth it. Right.
But when you're serious or you're going to get serious or whatever, I mean, prices don't scare me off. Of course, I do it for a living now, but prices don't scare me off as much. I may have to save, I may have to do side jobs. That was my thing. I put in shower doors when I was doing construction. That was my side job work, and I would pick stuff up. But with you guys, though, I would say and you guys might get pissed off at me. I'm not bringing up other companies' names. Pricing-wise, when you look at the bare bones, what am I trying to get? I hate it when somebody compares one of my products to somebody else's product, and it's the farthest thing from the good comparison.
Yeah.
It's like I got 19 other backpacks that match that. With you guys, like your Jetstream jacket, which is one of your more well-known jackets, that price-wise for a soft gel is on point. Well, I would not say that that is more expensive than any other jacket within $10, including the backpacking community, of a soft shell.
To further talk about Aaron's point, like a couple months ago, I got a magazine in the mail, and they did a review on backpacks. And I brought it to Aaron. I'm like, dude, they compared these companies for, like, top backpacks to your, like, bottom tier, like, entry level backpack,
and said, not apples to apples.
Yeah, it was like, wait a minute.
Yeah, again, you can skew it any way you want. Now, I'm not saying they probably didn't do that on purpose, but nonetheless, it wasn't a fair comparison.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah, yeah. Actually, on that case for me, they did, which you guys get, I'm sure too. I mean, that, I don't care. It is what it is.
It'll be biased at times, but looking at
price wise, if you take your, and I'm not saying this because you're working with us now. I'm saying it because I've bought a lot of your shit. If you take the most expensive thing you guys make.
Blizzard jacket and pants.
Yeah, it's expensive.
It is.
Okay, your cold front's expensive.
Yep.
But if you take the normal, I don't know, to me, the mountain pants and the ascent pants, I mean, most of those are probably more, the Timberline pants I actually use a ton, but the mountain and the ascent are like, what, $149 and $169, is that right?
Okay. Yeah, so this next, they moved up in price this year, yeah.
Yeah, well, they only moved up $10, right?
Yeah, well, the new Ascent pant is $189.
Okay.
But it's a complete rebuild. It's a whole realization.
Tell me this.
Even that new Ascent pant is equivalent to a pant that I used to get from Mammut in a different fabric, which I won't bring up, as far as tech specs, right?
Yeah.
But that pant from Mammut is $269 or $249. Yeah. So, I mean, to me, I guess what I'm getting at is when you compare apples to apples, because, I hear – Sitka's expensive. Well, you compare apples to apples, it's really not any difference.
Yeah, so that lightweight ascent pant, he's got a solid pair. So do I. We have a solid pair option this year. But
I've only got to try on a solid pair.
But, I've hunted, I was lucky enough. I've hunted 2 years in it. I sent it on 2 Cape Buffalo hunts, and I got it back on the first Cape Buffalo hunt. And I called my buddy. I'm like, George, I'm like, did you wear these? And he's like, oh, yeah. Like, didn't you see the picture of the bull I killed? And I'm like, you got to be shitting me. Like, these things still look brand new. Like, it's ridiculous. Like, I think there was one piece of thread that it pulled in the ash,
Yeah.
And, but it just, at that light of weight, for that kind of build with the feature set you're getting, like, it costs something. Like, these things aren't, like, they don't just happen by themselves,
Well,
or like the Blizzard. So just to give you a quick story, my buddy drew a muskox tag in Alaska, and he lives there. And he's like, hey, man, like, I'm doing this thing. It's going to be a snowmobile hunt. It's going to be 150 miles one way across pack ice. We're going to kill a muskox and come back in a couple of days. And I'm like, yeah, right. I hope you don't die.
No kidding.
And so, I helped him get some Blizzard stuff. And I was like, here's what you need. Like, don't worry. You'll be fine. He's like, really? I was like, trust me. Where would I send you? He did that hunt. He was back in 3 days, killed a beautiful muskox with his bow. Pope and Young caliber, and he's like, dude, he goes, I would have paid twice as much for that stuff for what it gave me.
Right.
And so for the right hunter, the right application, the right hunt, like nobody else makes anything like that in the hunting community.
Just gonna say, I have had something like that in conditions like you used to train in. It is no cheaper in the mountaineering community when you start to talk about that high down and then that much filled, not to confuse people, the amount of down you stuff in that jacket.
Yep.
And then that is no different than you look at, I won't start listing companies off, backpacking companies. You're looking at a lot of money. And the thing is, there's not a lot, but in the case of your jacket, there is probably 4 features I can think of in your jacket that adds money to that jacket compared to wearing a backpacker's jacket of that caliber, a mountaineer's jacket of that caliber. And those things, people don't realize, every little thing that's $10 here, $30 here, every little bit that you add to that to cater to a hunter, it adds money.
I'd rather give the hunter those features than strip them all off and not give them to him. Because at that point, are you really helping anybody out?
Yeah.
You're not.
Yep.
No, I don't think. Sense. We don't think.
Yeah. Got anything else?
Yeah, I want to ask John, you know, what was the 2017 product, gear item? Like, if you could pick one, what was the one that got you the most excited this
year? So for me, the one I've really been the most excited about and really kind of not surprised but just pleased at the reception mm-hmm. is the Ascent Vest. So yeah. it's something it's new, right? It's yeah. unique. It's a little different and
really.
So it's basically a hunting vest. It's a yeah. high performance hunting vest, and I'd been hunting in a version of that for 5 or 6 years, probably 6 years
yeah.
prior to coming to the company. And I had cobbled it together with a fly fishing vest and some, you know, so when you're in the military, you carry stuff on your chest because that's really the only other place you have, right, uh-huh. if you have a backpack on. And I'm like, all right, well, that kind of sparked an idea. The fly fishing vest sparked an idea. And then these ultra running vests, I used to run adventure races, that kind of sparked an idea. I cobbled this thing together. And so what you have is the Ascent Vest. And, you know, hunting vests have been out there, Primos Vest, you know.
Right,
but,
right.
But nothing in performance textiles, nothing that was designed for the backpack hunter.
I remember wearing the Primos archery vest.
I owned them,
little
sure.
pockets everywhere, yeah. could carry all my calls. And
yep.
But you're right, it wasn't performance-oriented whatsoever.
No, it wasn't. And so, you know, the reason I used the fly fishing vest as a foundation is because I was in Alaska and yeah. shit gets wet all the time. But
right.
You know, basically what I did, I'm not a smart guy, I guess, but yeah. I'm at least smart enough. And I put a white T-shirt on, I put a backpack on, I put my binos or bino bivy on in my case, mm-hmm. and I had a guy, the developer, take a Sharpie marker and just basically trace everything on the white T-shirt. And I said, that's the room we
that's
have.
That's pretty cool.
That's the room we have to work with. Yeah. Now what do I want it to do? Right?
Because it doesn't do you that. You run into that, like, I put my binos on, now I can't get to the zipper that I need to get to
correct.
That has my whatchamacallit
correct.
In
and
there.
The, and the way I designed it was you put the you either your binoculars on or the bino bivy on first. The vest goes over top. We've redone the bino bivy, kind of stripped a lot out of the harnessing. And then there's two buckles. And basically what it does is it locks this bino or bino bivy in place. And so if you're crawling, you know, a lot of times that thing will be dragging
right.
on the ground. Or if you got to sprint real quick, it'll smash you in the face. Like, it kind of locks it in place, but it's this chassis now where you have this totally this thing that you can totally custom out, right? Mm-hmm. So the lower left pocket you can put bear spray in if you want, if you're hunting in grizzly bear country, or you can put this little collapsible water bottle in there if you're going on a long stalk after a mule deer, or an arm guard. You know, there's places for, you know, how many times have you dropped your pack and then you're like, shit, like, where's my rangefinder? Or where's yeah. my diaphragm
right.
calls? Or holy shit, I left my wind check. Or worse yet, you go after a stalk. It's only going to be a couple hundred yards. You drop your pack. Now you're 2-3 miles into it. It's getting dark, and you're like, damn it, I left my GPS in my pack, and now I can't find my damn pack, right?
yeah.
And so you can customize this thing for your style of hunting, your species of hunting, and then you just grab it and go. And it's always on your body, and you know that, right? So
yep.
when you get in your tent at night, you can take it off. And the next morning you put it on and you
got
always have the essentials.
You.
And so I don't know, I'm kind of excited. It kind of makes me a little proud to be able to bring that kind of to the hunting community.
And the reception has been...
The reception.
I saw it at the SHOT Show.
Yeah, the reception's been really, really,
intrigued.
Really good.
That's
you know?
One of those pieces we don't expect the whole market to
no,
latch
we,
on to.
We,
I'm that's not going to lie. That's just, it's not my thing.
It
I
doesn't
think
have
I,
to be.
Well, I think it's
but
from,
it get, but we're talking about it, right? And so that's the cool thing.
Well, it is mine, like... That's totally my thing.
I've been, yeah. I was just going to say, I hate chest rigs, and you know why.
Yeah.
I hate carrying them around. I carried them around yep. for way too long. Now I even hate wearing a bino harness. I just do. I just don't like anything on my chest. But again, I have been caught with my pants down around my ankles with what you talk about on a few different items.
Yeah.
Now, not so much because it only happens once and you don't forget. But it everything that you described that goes in that vest, I have a rigged up something or other where it goes now that I hopefully don't forget. But
some
the vest...
people aren't as disciplined as you, though. They're constantly doing this. That bull's coming up, right, bugling, and you're like, as
oh,
you're
yeah.
dropping into a setup,
yeah.
you're like, where's my rangefinder? Where's my release, right?
Oh, yeah. No, and that's it makes very good sense.
Yeah.
But like you say, you know, it's not like you don't make 700 other things that work very well for what I do, but that
Yeah. I can see why you would like that, because that's a gamble. Not everyone is going to like
that. If you're an airhead like me and every night I put stuff in different places, I throw reeds on my sleeping in my tent and my brain and all these things, and every morning
I'm How many bugle tubes do you have spread out over the mountains?
I have bugle tube in every basin around Bozeman.
That's funny.
But it keeps me organized. At night, or when I get back to the truck or whatever at camp, I just make sure everything is all in the same place. I take it off.
That's my style.
Set it down. So I know when I get back, it's...
I'm disciplined in a different way, but so I don't do that, but I pray the military. But, I mean, I'm dressed where I dress on certain things, and I don't sleep. So I get up early. I have plenty of time to pre-pack, and I have my little checklist. Yeah. But I have friends that forget everything.
And we should hunt together. We would be really forgetful together.
But if you're talking apparel, I want to keep answering this question. But so the Ascent shirt is something new. So it's a technical hunting shirt, and, you know, a lot of people are like, well, why? And I'm like, because everybody hunts in their underwear. And like,
they do.
This shirt is designed with features for the hunter, right? For that backpack hunter. So one, it's a super lightweight nylon. So it's going to be durable. It's got the polygene on there, the quick dry. So it's hopefully going to cut down to some of the stink. It's going to like ridiculously dry, ridiculously fast. It's got printed mesh under the arms. It's got knit in the sleeves for bowstring clearance, but you can also pull them up if you need some extra venting. It's got two zippered chest pockets here that are mesh-backed, so you can use them as pockets if you'd like, or you can unzip them, and as you walk, air flows through the pockets and out the arms to provide additional ventilation. It's got a big half-zip, but then it's got a collar, and the collar does a couple things. One, backpack straps, bino straps don't chew into your neck. But how many times are you sitting there glassing and you're burning the hell out of your neck and you just flip the collar up? And now it's a sun collar. And then, like I said, it's got a 29 UPF rating, so it is giving you some sun protection.
Yeah.
So, that's something new. We'd never really done a technical hunting shirt before. So we were pretty stoked about that. And then the Kelvin Active Jacket is another piece that's it's never been done in the hunting space that I know of. Mm-hmm. It's something that, you know, there's a few that are popular in the mountain sports community, but it's a really, really breathable, lightweight, synthetic insulated jacket. So Santa's on a scale of 0 to 40, 0 being no breathability, 40 being very breathable, standard cubic feet a minute. Like, this is pushing the 40, right? So super breathable, lightweight piece, lightweight nylon shell, Polar Tech Alpha insulation in the middle, mesh backer, whole thing's polygene treated. You could put that in a bucket of water. I got to stop saying this because somebody's going to call me out on this, but maybe I'll call myself out on it. But if I have a lightweight base layer in this Kelvin Active Jacket, I put it in a bucket of water, I soak the shit out of it, I pull it out, I wring it out, there's not going to be a whole lot of moisture just inherently because of the textiles. Mm-hmm. I put those two things on and walk the show, and I come back and 45 minutes later, I'm going to be dry. Maybe not under my armpits. So
I'd buy that, though, be just from the sleeping bag testing we've done. Your body's heat generates a lot
huge
of
amount
heat.
Of heat, especially if you just start walking and generating that heat.
Well, I think where people have trouble wrapping their head around that, they've hiked around in cotton hoodies or something that doesn't dry fast.
It's not going to work.
If that textile does not hold a lot of water so you can wring it out, it won't take as much heat as someone thinks to dry that textile out.
And then you don't want a lot of resistance as that moisture moves through the system.
Yep,
that's just awesome.
So, anyways, those couple pieces are
when you told me about that, I got
critical.
A little bit of mountain wood because that's important for me.
Slip over here,
no kidding.
That's why I put you there
a couple weeks ago. No, when you had mentioned that, just because you get caught in situations, and generally, if we don't have to build a fire or I can walk it dry, a lot of times with my synthetic bag, I'll put. Which is important that I have textiles that dry fast. I'll sleep with them at night, and then they dry out by the morning. Yep. That's why when we were testing out a bunch of different textiles with the sleeping bags, we didn't want to make it for what we were doing that breathable, mostly because we couldn't find a fabric that breathable that was also as durable as we needed for a bag.
Because
we encourage guys to get in them on the side of the mountain.
Absolutely,
but the thinner that outer layer, the faster that crap dried on the inside because it was just heat trucking through, you know, getting it to dry. So.
But you said you put synthetic insulation in that, right?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
So on purpose. So, you know, it's a whole system approach.
Yep.
You can't stop at your base layer. You can't stop at your puffy layer. Like,
right.
like whatever your system is, the thought process has to be complete, right, from start to finish. Yep. However you use it.
Yeah.
However you use
yeah.
it.
No, that's cool. Well, what you have? I'm trying to think. Yeah, Thundercloud rain gear.
Thunderhead.
Thunderhead is new this year as well,
and that's a quiet rain gear.
Yeah. So
basically.
You know, a lot of guys hunting elk are hunting from a fixed camp, right? Mm-hmm. They're either packing in and hunting from a wall tent, or they're hunting from the trailhead or their truck or whatever it is. And you know, a lot of times rain gear's not quiet, but if you're going to stalk a bull, like when it's wet,
yeah.
or it's raining a little bit, right? Or you know, or even early morning when you're slipping through the dewy grass. So we wanted to make some rain gear that was quiet. So we looked to our, you know, our whitetail line and said, is there anything we've developed there that we could maybe bring in? And so we did find this three-layer Gore-Tex that has a brushed polyester face.
Yeah.
I'm not going to recommend it to the guy going on the 10-day hunt
yeah.
who's living in a tent, because eventually that face, just the face, is going to attract some burrs and some leaves, and it's going to get a little wet. And it's not, that face isn't going to dry super quick in your tent.
Yeah.
But if you're coming back and forth to a fixed camp, man, that is going to put you hopefully in the danger zone of that elk on some morning when any other thing would have either made you too loud or you'd have been soaked to your skin.
Well, I was going to say, Aaron and I have dealt with this. Like, we want to kill it. We, you know, we got our goal on that thing, and it's just not worth the risk. I'm soaked.
Yeah.
I'm just rained on and freezing.
That's all you've been able to do in
5-6 hours.
Oh,
yeah,
just it was
soaked.
A miserable shit day in Idaho. Well, we stayed 2 nights.
Yes.
Rained all day, every day, and it got to the point I didn't even try to wear rain gear.
But
right?
when we're
just,
close,
didn't
you,
matter.
You
just,
can't be wearing that rain gear. Can't yeah. you can't
No,
you,
no.
You can't do it.
Well, now you can. And so we call it the Thunderhead. It's a jacket and pant, and then we made a gator to go with it. So you kind of have
That'd
the
be
options
good for,
now
for northern Idaho.
My oh, buddies yeah. in the Pacific Northwest are pretty excited about it as
yeah.
well.
Yeah, perfect. Slipping through wet ferns yeah. and stuff like that. Yeah.
Roosevelt elk.
Now, are you offering the subalpine camouflage pattern in a lot of or some of the big game stuff? Are you transferring that over, or how's that working?
No, subalpine is in big game.
How would I put that?
The open country stuff.
Not everything
okay.
is or will ever be offered in just subalpine.
Okay,
because
I did a poor job explaining
yeah,
that.
Yeah, so
you get
for instance, the Thunderhead is a perfect example of that.
Yeah.
So the Thunderhead is purpose built for those, you know, guys
Dense.
In this case. Like slipping in, trying to kill elk, mule deer, bears, whatever, in that rainy
country.
Kind of stuff.
So you're probably not going to make that in open country.
That does not need to be an open country.
Vegetated environment,
it
shorter hunts.
You know, the sheep hunter doesn't need that.
But can
right?
you get a fanatic hoodie or a heavyweight core
yes.
in
subalpine? So all those kind of core functional pieces, mountain pant, timberline pant, all those.
Not the fanatic hoodie, though.
I've been asked this no less than 100 times by everyone, and I'm like, I think so, but guys, I'm relatively new to this.
Nah,
I'm like, I know their opti stuff and their big game stuff.
Not to have the guy have to edit this out, but that would have been cheese for me, quite frankly,
yeah.
to offer everything in the new pattern and go, oh, yeah, just buy it. Because, it's boring. Like, I want to build, Sitka builds purpose-built stuff.
Yeah. yeah.
Like, I want to build stuff specifically for that dude to have the best experience. Or gal in this case, right, for 2017.
Yeah.
So we were trying to build the best stuff we could for the elk mule deer hunter, the core Western hunter. I mean, even the guy up in Maine slipping through the woods, right, trying to kill his moose up there. Like, we wanted to offer products for that. We offer great products for the guy going above timberline, and we'll continue to do that.
Yeah.
But there's no reason to offer everything we – like, you know, the blizzard. Like, I don't know if I need to offer the – you know,
right.
make that right now. Like, I might, but there's got to be a really compelling case for me to do that. And it's not financial. It's, is that the best product for that end use? And does that camel pattern, as one of the kind of the frosting on the cake, does that make sense?
Gotcha.
So I would say at this point, 2/3 of the line, so all the new stuff, but holistically 2/3 of the line has subalpine. And maybe there's some overlap, so maybe 2/3 has open country, but not the whole,
gotcha.
Not the whole thing.
Which makes sense.
Yep.
So. Yeah, it does.
Yep.
Cool. Are we needing to wrap this up?
Yeah,
I'm ready for a pee break myself.
Aaron and I have hit our potty limit. It's about 45 minutes to 60. 60's pushing it.
Yeah.
I literally, that's the closest I've come to pissing my pants as a grown man. With Mark just would not stop talking.
We'll hunt well together.
That's funny.
Yeah, we will. I'm excited about this. Appreciate it. We're gonna hunt with Brinker this year.
I heard that.
Yeah.
Well, Alberta.
Are you going to, like, suffer with the struggle stick or do the compound? Or
we'll just have to wait and see, won't we?
Bring a little of both.
I would personally bring, like, a silenced...
A nuclear bomb?
6.5, maybe. And then we'll just... You get behind it, I'll put the longbow in front of it.
I'm just going to watch you guys. I'm just going to watch you guys stalk, man. That'll be enough entertainment.
It is fun, dude. It's a fun hunt.
It is fun. We got to watch a few stalks get blown ourselves, and... It's always easy from the armchair, no matter if it's an armchair in a tundra. And I'm watching, and I'm thinking, would I have done that? No. Oh, yeah, I would have done that. And then deer blowing everywhere. So it is a
I get more nervous watching other people stalk.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
I played whack-a-mole for, I don't know, 40 minutes.
We were talking mad shit when he was doing that.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, Lander's like, what's he doing? I'm like, I don't know what he's doing. He can see those deer. He wants to kill one. But Brian wanted to kill those deer so bad, and those deer wanted to get to that bean field so bad. It was like he'd come over, and they'd go back, and they'd go around, and he'd see him over there, and he'd go that way. And it was funny because we're 1,000 yards watching him.
I'm blocking him. I'm playing like
– Yeah.
But there was these little coolies, and I'd pop up, and I'd go, there they are, and I'd sneak around, and I'd pop up, and then they'd see me, and they'd run over here, and they were just, where's he going to pop up? Oh, there he is, and there's the buck there, and I just –
You shot that muley with your recurve, right?
Yeah.
I did.
Yeah, I mean, 186, big buck. Yeah.
Mule deer with a...
It's impressive.
With traditional gear is not easy. I was watching my buddy stalk a mule deer last year in Oregon, and I mean, just like you say, everything's so easy when I'm down in spotting scopes. Like, oh, why would he turn that way? Don't. you're trying to give him hand signals, and I was getting so passionate about it. It looked like I was moonwalking, He's like, I just kept looking back. It looked like you were dancing. I'm like, no, I was trying to tell you to go down the hill. And so finally he gets down in position, and he's sitting there like this, and the buck's behind him, but I couldn't figure out how to tell him behind. We hadn't really studied our hand signals that well that day. And the buck stands up, and I have a picture of him through the spotting scope, and he's sitting here like this, and the buck is standing. And to me, it looked like it's in bow range, so I'm like, oh, my God, this is catastrophic.
Right.
Yeah.
But come to find out, it was like 100 yards away, because he finally turned around, and then he wasn't shooting. I'm like, why is he not shooting? Shoot.
Yeah. And he comes down. At those distances, it's hard to tell.
Oh, yeah. He comes down the hill. I'm like, dude, you're killing me, man. Like, I was going to have a heart attack. He's like, dude, it was 100 yards away.
Oh, man, that's funny. Yeah. Well, cool. Well, we should probably end this.
Yep. So I can go thanks, John. Thanks, David.
Oh, thanks.
Yeah, appreciate
stay gritty.
Yep. Yeah, man. You too.
What are you doing the pound for now?
I like it, man.
I don't know.
It just makes me feel tough. I want to say thank you. I can shake hands.
it's not as cool.
Not as cool.
It's not as gritty.
The future of public lands. All of us own them. All of us use them. Political activists are demanding us to hand over the public lands where the state's legislators could transfer and control these lands. U.S. citizens own 640 million acres of public lands, which creates 6.1 million jobs and generates $646 billion per year.
States have been selling off land to pay bills for over 100 years, thus closing access to the public. 39% of original 64 million acres have been sold. The cost of land management would break most state budgets. For instance, who will pay the hundreds of millions of dollars to fight major wildfires each year? It doesn't matter how many promises are made. The financial reality is it will force states to have to sell off our public land.
President Theodore Roosevelt said, "We must preserve our lands for future generations, not merely to the people now alive, but to the unborn people. Our duty to the whole bids us restrain an unprincipled present-day minority from wasting the heritage of these unborn generations."
This is Ty Stubblefield, and you're listening to the Gritty Bowmen.
Gritty Bowmen.